Good morning. Good morning. It is Donna here from Motuoru Development. I hope you are all well out there. Today is going to be a full program. I have a really interesting subject and on journaling. So the benefits of journaling is what I'm going to talk about today. So I thought I'll start by introducing myself and talk a little bit about Motuoru Development. At the end, I'm going to give some details on how you can get hold of us if you're interested in any of our services and keep you informed on what's going on. So, Donna, I am a local here. In fact, I was born here, so I can definitely say I'm a local. So born in Masterton and lived out the Wakatake for a while until we came back into town for schooling. Lived in town for a while, and now I live rurally with my partner. We have a sheep stud. So I am a social worker. I have been for over 35 years, a registered social worker. I have a business in town which is called Motuoru Development that has a team of social workers that go out and work with the community, working with vulnerable families out there and supporting and helping people that really need a little bit extra support and help along the way. We also run education programs as well, amongst other things. And as the shows go on, you'll find out more and more about what we do because we're a very busy, busy place with lots going on. So I am a nana of seven, and some of my grandchildren actually come on the show once a month on the Motuoru Youth Show once a month. So yeah, they're following nana's lead and working on radio as well. I love being a nana. It's a very special time, and I love that I'm in the playground and not in the classroom, so I can actually relax and just purely enjoy the kids, which has been wonderful. It's one of the benefits of getting older, I think, is having grandchildren. I am legally blind. I have retinitis pigmentosa, which is a degenerative disease where I am losing my sight. I have very little sight now. I have almost sort of on just around the palm of my hand. For anyone that can see me, it's the palm of my hand. But if you're not, that's about all I can see. I do have a guide dog, so you probably have seen me on the streets walking up and down with my guide dog Kenzie. So Kenzie is a Labrador. She's a very blonde Labrador, so she's quite blonde. But she certainly has been an amazing help for me along my way. I get around a lot easier with her. I also do use a cane, but a cane is it's very useful, but it's the how I compare it is a cane is the roll is roller skates, and Kenzie is the Mercedes. So you know that's the difference really on how I can get around either on roller skates or in a Merc. So Kenzie's my Merc. So that's a little bit about me and Motuoru Development. So I'll fill you in a little bit about my business that I've set up. I set it up 4 years ago, and it is because I have been a social worker for a very, very long time and am very committed to supporting our community in any way. I decided to set up this business to enable people to get support. A lot of people's problems now, and I'm sure you'll agree, is they're a lot more complex than in the old days. There is a lot more going on in the planet and in the community. There is a lot more information out there for people, but our worlds are a lot more complicated than in the 50s, for example. You know, mum stayed home, dad went to work 9 to 5 or 8 to 5. You know, the kids went to school, and that was, you know, you sat for dinner, and the world is a lot more complicated. You know, often two parents working, and very, very complicated world, and a lot more challenging, I believe. I know it was difficult then too, but I think it's a lot more challenging nowadays. And we just need a little extra support. One of the things that I've recognised over the years is that there's a big generational gap in a big gen no, there's not a big generational gap. Hang on, I'll reword that. There is a big geographical gap between families now. So we are spread out a lot more. Remember when I grew up, I had sort of Auntie Jean down the road and my nanny Kelly would come and visit and all the time and lived close and friends were very close and my school was very close. But now, you know, we're a lot more spread out. So we don't have our aunties down the road or our nanas down the road like we used to. And I think that does... Well, I more than think, I know research has shown, and I, you know, certainly academically have discovered it, but also personally and professionally know that if you don't have those supports, those close supports, there's a lot of challenges around that. You don't learn things naturally and symbiotically with your family. You miss sort of those generational, you know, learning that we would normally pick up by just spending time at our nanas and cooking scones with them and that sort of thing. So I wanted my place, Motuoru Development, to be that place where you could learn those things and be that, you know, be able to walk in and just feel like you had some aunties down the road that were able to support you and sort of give you some advice and some gentle learning, but also, you know, be professional and add some academic learning in that as well. So that's what I started with Motuoru Development. I used the words motu and oru, which are both... I use them in the verb sense, so motu meaning to be unstuck and oru to being not bogged down. And so when I put them together, I felt that, you know, the meaning for that for me was that I would like to help people keep moving forward. And I think that's where we need to be now, is trying to just move forward. Even if it's an inch, it is still moving forward. One inch is moving forward. So if your world is really, really difficult at the moment and you are in a challenging place, just think one inch is moving forward. So, so that's where Motuoru came from. I'm really proud of the name and the meaning that I have behind it. It's been blessed and it's been accepted by the National Māori Advisory. And so it's, you know... out there, I know using two verbs together is unusual, but in our world, we put lots of words together so to make meaning and sense from them, and that's what I've done, and that's what's happened. So Motuoru Development is, as I said, I've got a team of different people that do different jobs. We get some government funding that helps us with parenting programs and social work supports for vulnerable families. I also work doing counselling for EAP services, which provides an income to support youth. So we run youth programs, which is Motuoru Youth, run a radio Arrow FM show on the alternate fortnight to me. So I run this once a month on Wednesday mornings, beg your pardon, at 10 a.m. and they run theirs on the alternate week. I'm not sure if it's 3 or 3:30, beg your pardon on that one, but Arrow FM have this amazing website that you can go to. You can click the links and listen to past shows or listen to the show when it's becomes available, but it also has all the time slots in it. So I advise you to check Arrow FM out. It's well worth it. Other wonderful shows as well. So the youth... run a show as well, and they are really loving it, and the growth from the youth from just having that something they kind of have to do but really want to do but are scared to do but do it, and then they, you know, come out afterwards just really hyped up, and you know, although they're very, very nervous, they do a brilliant job, and I've listened to their show and thoroughly enjoyed it. Sometimes they're just simply playing games, but this is the learning that you get that I think is often missing. You know, you would have youth playing Uno in the dining room while the parents were sitting in the lounge, and then there's all that talking that happens and all that learning and all that relationship stuff that happens within that valuable time. So, that's a little bit about us and a little bit about what we do. There's so much more. one of the things that I am going to talk about shortly is journaling. It's something that I'm personally very passionate about, but also research has shown the beatitudes of it and the benefits physiologically and psychologically. So I'm going to talk a bit about that next. But what I want to do now is play a song so that I can get ready for my next set. And I'm just going to pull up my liked music list. So all the songs you're going to get are songs that I really enjoy and listen to regularly. And the first one I'm going to play is L.A.B. In the Air. Enjoy. Well, that seems to have gone dead. I'm not sure what happened there. I think it's my phone. I don't think it's the station. I have a feeling it's my phone.
It's on pause. Yeah.
So, anyway, we'll try again. Oh, we've got Maroon 5. I know what it is, Michael. I know what it is. I've worked it out. Donna's worked it out. Don't worry. But I have realised that my Spotify is not on my premium on this phone and it just plays the start. But that's okay. We'll work with that. So I wanted to talk about journaling. Journaling is something that I have been really passionate all my life. I mean, I had a journal while in my youth. I called it a diary. Yes, that's what we called them in the old days. You know, I used to have a diary and I'd go, dear diary, and how my day was, and then I'd put my thoughts down. But what I recognised while I was doing that is that I actually felt really good afterwards. You know, it was a way of sorting out my thoughts and sorting out my feelings and really working things out in my head. I kind of liken it to everything in my head is kind of like it's in a jigsaw puzzle that's been all mushed up. And so when I journal, I get everything, all those jigsaw puzzle pieces out of my head, and I put them out, and then I sort out the corners, and I sort out the sides, and I put the blues in one area, and I put the greens in one area, and the trees in one area, and then I put it all back in my head in order. And so, and then I have kind of a sense of a picture and a plan moving forward. And that's what journaling does for me. And so on my academic journey and professional journey, I wanted to know why I felt so good after journaling and what the benefits long term might be for me. Because I didn't know any of that. I just knew as a young woman that I felt good afterwards. And so I did do some study on journaling. Now, one of the interesting things is that, you know, when we're stressed, we often have disorders that pop up, you know, respiratory things that tend to be stress-provoked, bronchial and asthmas. We have skin disorders that are often, provoked by stress again. So things like psoriasis and eczema. Those things tend to flare up when we're stressed. You know, there are other reasons, medical reasons, of course, as well, and for those issues. But often they flare up when we're stressed. So what doctors wanted to do was test biologically what happens in our body while we are actually doing journaling. So they did some tests. What they discovered is while we are journaling, what happens in our body is we have things called lymphocytes. These are a cell, and the lymphocyte, specific lymphocyte called the T lymphocyte, is specific to improving eczema, asthma, psoriasis, and all of those other issues, the skin and respiratory issues that happen when we are stressed. So while we are journaling, the medical profession discovered that those T lymphocytes increase. So naturally, we are finding a natural way of increasing something in our body that helps to improve those issues. So that was huge for me. I thought, gosh, that is huge. So one of, you know, if they can medically discover that while we're doing something that I just simply feel good doing is medically helping me, that's a big tick for me. So bonus on journaling. So if you do struggle with those sort of issues, you know, that is maybe something to think about, is, you know, some journaling. The other thing that is interesting with journaling is, so people, it helps you set goals. It helps you find your values, what you value in life, and helps you want to set goals towards that while you're journaling. Now, this is an interesting one because there's some people, some well-known people on the planet that have journaled. Ronald Reagan is a great example. He was an avid journaler. Winston Churchill was an avid journaler. Matthew McConaughey, sorry, this is fuzz brain. Matthew McConaughey is an avid journaler. In fact, he does workshops online on how to journal well. So those are a few of the ones that journal, but obviously the obvious one that's actually saved your life was Anne Frank. So a young woman that journaled while she was hiding within the war under floorboards, and it kept her sane and saved her life. So there is a long list, a much longer list of journalers, but those are the ones that I can just remember off the top of my head. So, and I mean, these are high achieving people. So that's, you know, one of the things that has helped them is being able to set goals and see clarity in their thoughts so that they can move forward in doing their jobs. So that's number two, big tick number two. Now, we all know that Asian medication and Asian lifestyles, example, you know, the yin and the yang and feng shui and all of the, you know, medications, the natural herbs and things that they use have been wonderful and centuries old. So they've been proven over centuries that they work. So what they've discovered is centuries and centuries ago, they have discovered journals. So even way back when, they knew that journaling helped, even when they didn't have the medical ability to discover it. So they have found in China a journal dated way, way back in centuries ago. So you just can't go wrong. So there's another big tick. You know, it's proved over the centuries that it's proven to help. So that's the sort of whys, the biological whys. Now, the physiological whys. So what happens when we're stressed? And if you want to go back over my last radio show, I talked about stress management, and I talked about the brain and what happens in our brain physiologically when we are stressed. So one of the things that I talked about was that our thinking part of the brain, which is up in our prefrontal cortex, right at the top of our forehead, right at the front of our head, which is our higher functioning part of our brain, that can get quite overwhelmed, and because we take away the energy from it when we're in stress mode, and so it can get overwhelmed and it can get foggy headed. So what they've discovered, that while you're journaling, that prefrontal cortex starts to clear a bit, starts to calm down a bit, as the energy starts coming back to it, because the emotional part of our brain, which is all revved up in preparation for fight, flight and freeze, starts to settle, because you start thinking, okay, I don't need to fight anybody. I don't need to run like Billy O, or I don't need to hide and freeze. So it starts to settle. And that is what happens physiologically with your brain while you are journaling. Big tick. So we can now say physiologically, we've seen what happens within the brain psychologically while we are journaling. So those are some massive ticks on proving what journaling can do. Of course, I can put one big massive tick up, because I've just personally found it helps. So I've got a list here of some of the reasons why we journal and what what the benefits are. So I'm going to just talk through them a little bit, one at a time. So the art of writing. No, so it gives clarity to your thoughts and feelings. So that's exactly what I was saying about the prefrontal cortex and the thinking. So it starts turning the prefrontal cortex back on and you start thinking clearly and start thinking much more. You know, when we're really stressed and we get that really foggy, overwhelmed feeling when we start just not being able to think clearly at all, this is one of the things that it really helps. It also starts clearing our feelings, our emotions. We start being able to write our emotions down. You know, sometimes we put one big emotion as what we're feeling, like, I am really angry today. But if we start writing it down, what we might be recognizing is things like, I'm really scared because the big power bill's on its way and I know it's going to be a big one. Or I'm really sad that my nana has gone travelling overseas and won't be back for 3 months and I just love being with my nana. Or that I am, you know, really confused about something, like maybe mum and dad have split up or had a fight and I just don't know how to work that out in my head. So it really starts helping you break down those feelings. So instead of just being angry, big angry, and wondering what on earth's going on, it breaks it down into smaller feelings that you can actually start working on. You can start processing, because big anger is a very hard thing to process. But if you can start breaking it down into those smaller bits, it's much easier to process. Now, what's the next one? You get to know yourself better. Now, this is one that I have to agree with totally. So one of the things that people often say to me is, how do I gain confidence? How do I get self-esteem? And my answer, one of my answers, is that start to get to know yourself. Find out who you are. Find out what you like. Find out what you don't like. Find out what upsets you and what angers you and what makes you happy. And so journaling really does help you get to know yourself. So you can often look back and read things from the past, and that, you know, you can learn from that. You can write things about what might be going to happen in the future and plan for that. So you really start to get to know who you are as a person. And I think that that's one way of finding out, getting to know yourself. Accepting who that person is the next step. And I'll bring some things in another show on how you can do that. But for now, it is just getting to know who you are, which is quite different than accepting who you are. And so that's getting to know yourself. It reduces stress. And as I've said about the T lymphocytes, so obviously they increase, which supports the respiratory and skin disorders, but it also has been shown to decrease cortisol, which is one of our main stress hormones. Now, we do need cortisol. We need cortisol to get out of bed. We need cortisol to go to work. We need cortisol to get in the car and drive. We need that sort of to get us going. But too much of that get us going stuff is, it's dangerous. It's bad in our system. And I have talked about this in a past show. It is like a weed killer in our system. So we need to reduce stress. And journaling has been proven to do that in so many ways. And some of those big ticks that I've been talking about. Solve problems more effectively. Now, that's a really good one. So one of the things that's interesting about us is we have a thing called the amygdala, which is right in our emotional part of the brain. Now, amygdala in Latin means almond, because it's a little almond-shaped system, and it is one of our main systems for anxiety and fear. And so anxiety and fear come about because we're the only critters on the planet that have anxiety and fear, because what happens that humans can do that others can't, for example, my dog Kenzie can't do it. So if there's a piece of meat on a plate, Kenzie, my guide dog, It's input in and input out. So she would just see that, input in, she'd go, oh, meat, eat it, input out, gone. So that's how nice and simple it happens for Kenzie. But for us, we have a memory. We think back in the past and we learn from, well, we hope we learn from the past, but we do think back in the past. We also have the ability planning forward and thinking forward and future thinking and dreaming forward. So this amygdala uses those two things. It uses the planning, the thinking back and the planning forward to decide on how much anxiety and fear we need, or whether it's a positive anxiety, because, you know, there are good anxieties. That's what makes us do things. And there's good fears, you know. That's why we have theme parks and roller coasters. So there are good fears and anxieties, but they're also not so good ones. So, for example, if that plate of meat was here and a human came along, they would look at it. And they would go, oh, I wonder what that plate of meat's there for. And they'd start thinking back. They'd start thinking, oh, I wonder who left it there and why they left it there and what it would be for. And then they start thinking forward and thinking, I wonder what I could do with that piece of meat. You know. And then they start building these two together and they start thinking, I could actually cook that for tea. And if I put onions with that, that would be quite nice, and maybe some garlic. And then you start adding and adding and adding and think, oh, if I jot that down, you know, that would be a really good recipe. And next minute you're creating this recipe book just simply by seeing this piece of meat. And Kenzie's way off looking for another piece of meat because it's input in, input out, and it's gone. Whereas us as humans have really built and created a recipe book from this piece of meat. Now, that's how some of our anxiety and fears work in a positive way. And of course, they work in a negative way as well, and can work in a negative way, especially if our emotional part of the brain, our fight, flight, and freeze systems have been aggravated and are feeling really raw and throbbing. And of course, our amygdala, our anxiety, one of our main anxiety systems is within that part. So it gets aggravated and starts getting big, and that's how anxiety, one of the reasons why anxiety and fear happens. So that was a big explanation to say that it helps us solve problems more effectively, because we, as I say, can look at that piece of meat and whatever it is that's in front of us, and we can start thinking about the past and thinking about the future and planning and working around that problem that we've got, and helps create some answers for it. The next one, resolve disagreements with others. Well, that's an interesting one. So if you are having, and you know, this life happens, we do have debates, arguments, grumps with our family members and our friends. It does happen. We are all totally independent, different individuals, and sometimes we rub against each other. And one of the sayings that I like is, a diamond is made by grinding all the sides, and that's what happens with friendships. You know, you can get a beautiful diamond of a friendship, but you've got to rough it up and buff it up and do all those sorts of things to get that beautiful diamond. So by journaling, you can actually reflect on conversations you've had with your friends or situations you've had with your friends and family, and work through why that's happened. So often if you start journaling and you write in the third person, so you're not writing from your perspective, you're writing from a completely independent person's thought person's perspective, or you start trying to write from that person's perspective and try and get a sense of what actually they're feeling and thinking. So there's some real ability to be able to work through challenging conversations, and even positive fun. You know, how do I do something like ask my girlfriend to marry me, or how do I apologize to my mate that I've upset by being, you know, sharp-tongued by accident. So, you know, you can really work through those challenges through journaling. Okay, so what's the next one? It will help you clarify your goals. So it will help you clarify your goals. The reason it does that, or one of the reasons it does that, is because we can start thinking about what we value. Now, you can't create goals without knowing what you value. You can set a goal. For example, you might say, I'm going to lose 10 kilos in 3 months. And so that's your goal, but you fail. And you look back and you think, why didn't I succeed in that? Well, maybe maybe it is that you don't have an issue with your body. Maybe you made too big a goal. It was too overwhelming. Maybe it was too big, too much amount in too short a time. So these are the things that you can reflect on. But also, if you don't value something that you're setting a goal for, you won't achieve it, or it's going to be more difficult. So if you want to buy a car, but you don't value, if you really value being fit and being healthy and you value our environment, then maybe your decision might end up being, I'm going to buy a bicycle. The benefit from that would be that you could lose weight. So losing the weight is the benefit. It's not the actual goal. So you need to find what you value. So if you value travel, then you have to find, okay, I value the planet and I value learning more about it. So that means the benefit will be that you can travel. So how do you do that? I'm not sure if I'm explaining this very clearly, but I think in other sessions we'll get to it in more detail. So I guess what I'm, the synopsis is, if you've got to find out what you value in order to put goals in it. So if you discover that you really value time with your parents, well, then you can set a goal around how to do that. If you discover that you really value your work colleagues, then you can put a goal around how you manage that. If you don't value something, then you won't be wanting to work towards it. But if you want to set a value-based life, then find out what you value. And that's, journaling will definitely help you with that. I'm not sure. That's a tricky one for me to explain outwardly, but it's because I think it happens, in your heart. Let me see what the next one is. We can simplify our life. Simplify our life. And this is something I know my partner and I have talked about this quite a bit over the last few years. We really want to simplify our life. I think we get way too complex, much too complex. And I started the show with saying, we lived in a simpler world. And there are things that we can simplify, but I think sometimes you have to sort of work through them to find out what they are. And also, if our life is quite complex and busy, we can be so overwhelmed by that we actually can't see the forest for the trees. So we need to sit down and spend time looking at those individual trees to see what the forest looks like. And so simplifying our life is something that we need to do. Oh, no, I won't say we need to do. Simplifying your life certainly is something that my partner and I value. We value a simple life. We value simplicity and we value non-complicated. So our goal setting is around, how do we simplify our life? How do we make it so that we can create a full, enriched life, but make it a simple life at the same time? So that's, we're now setting ourselves goals around that. And I've journaled around that as well and try and work that out. So I guess that's a good one to show you the values and goal settings ones. But simplifying your life so that it's less complicated, that doesn't mean, let's all go hermit in the forest or live like that wonderful family that I've followed, read, that lived down on the west coast of the South Island. That was a fascinating and interesting thing. And they really decided particularly the husband, forgotten their names now, but to live a very, very simple life way out in isolation. I'm not suggesting that everybody goes off and isolates himself, because we need family. We're a social animal. We need family. We need community. One of the things that has been proven for healthy mental health and longevity in life is to have a good social connection and family connections around you. So I'm suggesting things, the simplifying things is like how many emails you receive a day. You know, can you simplify that? How many meetings do you go to a week? How many text messages do you send a day that could be simplified? You know, so you can still have those true and enriched relationships with people, but do you have to send a text message every hour to them, or can you, you know, ring them for half an hour once a day and simplify your life during the day so that you've got 10 minutes more in your hours, in your each hour during the day, to do something, you know, that you really value? Not that you don't value your friends, but you in time management terms, and it's another show that I would like to talk about, in time management terms, it is called chunking. So I'll talk about chunking more, but it is chunking things into much more efficient ways of working. So, yeah, that's something that my partner and I are definitely working on, and I'll fill you in on sort of things along the way on how we do that. So what we've, you know, we've really at the stage of we've talked at that this is what we value. We value a simplified life in the future for us, and that's what we've decided, and now we're starting on, you know, what goals do we need to set and how can we manage that, and breaking it down into bits. So, I'll happily share that journey with you along the way, but the big thing for us really was, what do we value? And that was really because we started getting unwell, started feeling burdened and pressured, you know, with even things that we really enjoyed, we were feeling burdened and pressured in time to get there and etc. So it's been a big thing for us, and I will follow that journey through with you if you're interested. I hope you are, and let you know where we're going with that one. So the next one is, it will strengthen your relationships. And I think that also comes back to what we talked about before, about working out your relationships and connections with people. So it will strengthen your relationships. So if you, again, have some complications in your relationships or want to strengthen your relationships, journaling is a great way of finding ways to clear things in your head so that you can work forward. And or suggesting that your family member or your or person you're in a relationship with journals as well. You know, it might be something that they really will benefit from and learn from. Don't go too hard on it. Just, you know, be gentle. Give them, plant the seed and lead by example. So it really does strengthen your relationships. I certainly understand myself and my relationships a lot clearer after I've done some journaling. And if I'm feeling that I'm getting shaky on it, that is time for me to journal. And one of the things I think I said was, I don't think I've said actually, is that often I find that the time that I journal the most is when things are challenging for me in the world, when things are going tickety-boo and I'm happy as I've hardly pick up my journal and I think, oh, I haven't journaled for a long time. And then I might find that things are a bit sort of, oh, help. And that's when I start getting my journal out. So I will shortly talk about how to and things to in order to do it so that it's setting you up in a clear way. So I will talk about those soon. So the next one is, it will empower you. Well, it's only going to make you stronger. If you start talking about all these things that are you know, start thinking about all these things and reflecting on these things and starting really getting to know yourself and having a clear direction, it's going to make you feel empowered. It's going to make you feel strong. And I'm still trying to find out how to work at putting a song on, but I'm going to give up because I do know what the problem is now, guys. I really do. So, yeah, so that's the next one for me is how do you... it will empower you. Sorry, I lost my thread there because, again, I was going changing the ADHD. Here we go. I think I can do a whole show on ADHD one day too because I know I've got it, adult ADHD. So that's another show. But sorry, I did lose the thread there. So empower you. It will empower you. There we go. So that's the journaling part. So one of the keys, that's sort of, so what I've done is talked about what happens physiologically and biologically when you are actually in the act of journaling. So there has been research and tests and trials and lots of research to prove the benefits of journaling that way. And then I talked about what the benefits are and what will you actually gain from journaling. And research has also proved these to be correct, and I personally can attest that these are what I have discovered over the many, many years that I've journaled. But I think there's some precautionary things. So also, when you start journaling, so the first thing to do is, these are my tips on how to start. You've listened to this and you've thought, right, I really want those things in my life. I want to be empowered. I want to have good, healthy relationships. I want to know what I value in this world. I want to set plans on that. So you start thinking that, and you think, right, Donna's told me that journaling will do this, so I'm going to do it. So how do you do it? So then you start thinking, okay, well, how on earth am I going to do this? And this is where my next section is. I'm going to tell you the hows. So the first thing to do is don't go and spend a lot of money on this. You can go to Uncle Bill's and get a $3, notebook. You don't need any big, flash, fancy journals. Don't start with anything expensive. I'm not suggesting you do that at all. Once you've started to get into journaling and you realise that it's part of your life, you may want to, and that's great. And I must confess, I tend to buy a new journal once a year. Sometimes they're full, and sometimes they're not. Sometimes a journal might last me a couple of years, especially if it's a beautiful one. I do spend quite a bit of money on my journal. I love having something really lovely. Either it's really tactile, or it's really beautiful, or it's got some sort of meaning to it in the cover and the paper. And so those things, the smell of the journaling and the writing and moving pages over. Anyone that's an avid reader or writer will know that feeling of, what paper feels like. But please don't start with something really expensive. We don't want to set you up for failure. So just start with something cheap, and a good old big biro and a $3 notebook from Uncle Bill's. So that's number one. Number two is you really want to be able to write in your journal so that you get gain from it. So you want to be able to write without consideration of who might read it. Because if you were writing in a journal and all you can think is, I better not write that because so-and-so might read it, or I better not write that because my partner might find it, or, oh gosh, I better not write that because my mum might find it, you're not going to gain anything from it. So think about your privacy. So in modern days, a lot of people do the journaling online, and you can get lots and lots of journals that have, secure folders and that sort of thing. You can also buy journals that have locks on them nowadays as well. So, consider your privacy. So I've been journaling all my life, and I can leave my journal out because my partner just wouldn't even bother looking at it because it's just always there. But yeah, you can keep it in your bag, you can tuck it under your mattress, you can have it in a special drawer in your room. yeah, just consider your privacy, because you will not benefit if you are worried about what you are writing, and you can't do that. To get the full benefits from journaling, you have to be able to write free flow. So that's number two. Number three is, do not worry about grammar. You know, this isn't an academic writing. This isn't something that you have to go and get checked or edited. It is for you. So it doesn't matter about spelling. It doesn't matter about full stops. It doesn't matter about capitals, any of that sort of stuff. Because if you start worrying about the semantics of your writing, you are going to stop the flow. You're going to stop that natural flow of what's coming out of your brain into your paper. You get halfway through it and you've got this beautiful stuff coming out of your head and it's rolling off your pencil, your biro beautifully, and then you all of a sudden think, oh, you know, that's a long paragraph. I better stop and start a new paragraph. Well, you don't need to do that. Do not worry about grammar. Really, really important. So that's number three. Number four is... don't expect to be able to do 2 hours of journaling a night right from the get-go. Start small. Start very small. Start with, you know, 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Just start with just a little bit. Just put your pen to the paper. You don't have to write Dear Diary or anything like that. Put your pen to the paper and just write what comes straight out of your head. And just start small. You might find the flow and you might, spend 2 hours writing. That's great. But it's a skill. Journaling is a skill that you can't do naturally unless, you know, some people can. Of course, there's people that can. But most people can't do it naturally. So don't expect to be able to just naturally write. Just start small. Just check what the time is, guys, so that I don't run out of time and Michael and Veronica come and go, oh, time. No, we've got a few more minutes. We're just about finished. So you start small. Don't start big. So those are my let's be careful about this. Let's start properly. We don't want to set you up for failure. So consider your privacy. Don't worry about your grammar. Start small and build on it slowly. And don't spend a lot of money on it. So that's the four main keys to starting. Now, one of the things that I think I'm not going to talk about this in detail because it's a whole show on its own, really. But one of the things I like to do, and this is just food for thought for you for future journaling when you start, is... in the psychological world, we talk about the 8 areas of human existence. So these are the 8 areas that make us a whole person. So it's kind of like the pieces of the pie. So 8 pieces, pie pieces sliced and make a whole pie. And that's who we are. So the areas are intimacy. So that's your personal connections, your relationship or your deep intimate relationships. Your family. Your friends, your hobbies, what blows your hair back, what do you enjoy, your work, paid and voluntary, your spirituality, so that can be religion, but that can also be your wairua, or your just what's your feelings inside. It's not particularly talking about religion, it's more spiritual, meditative. Your knowledge, what do you learn? Do you learn every day? Do you want to be a seeker of information? And the last one is diddly diddly diddly. It'll come to me. I've lost it, but I'm going to do a show on that anyway. So when I get my new journal, what I do is I write those 8 areas of human existence down on the inside cover of my new journal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I've actually added a 9th one, which is finances, because I like to look at my whole financial situation when I'm journaling as well. So when I'm journaling, I try and make sure that I spend a little bit of time on each of those areas. So am I am I, you know, considering my relationship? And am I considering my spirituality? Am I physical? That's the other one. Am I considering my physicality? Am I considering my work? So that you've got a holistic look at what you're considering within your journal. So it's a really good thing to be able to not look, because what we can tend to do is just focus on one area. So it's like, oh gosh, I feel big and blobby today and I want to lose weight. So you just focus on that whole area in your journal instead of actually looking at the whole realistic, whole, you know, areas of existence. So that's a show I can put on in the future and go into more detail around that. But, you know, something to consider is to make sure you're looking at your whole self when you're journaling. So that's my story, my advice, my research, and my academic knowledge on journaling. So I'm hoping that you've gained something from that, and I'm hoping that you will try it. Just try it. And if I see a journal flying across the road, you know, I will know that it's not for you. And sometimes in my years of, I've been doing social work for 35 years and I've been teaching about journaling for probably 20 of those years. There is the odd person that it's just not for them. They just cannot get journaling. But there is others. There are different ways of journal too, and that's another session as well. But there's things like bullet pointing. Sometimes I just scribble and draw, or I stick things in my journal, or I write a poem, or I write down the lyrics of a song. Or there's so many things you can do. I write letters of forgiveness, or letters of thankfulness, or, you know, there's so much that you can write in your journal. It's such an enriching thing to do. So I do really encourage you to get out and give it a try. There we go. That's my session today on journaling. Now, I did want to talk a little bit about some of the things that are coming up. So Motuoru Development, you can contact us if you want more information on 0800 080 171. Or you can contact me personally on Motuoru Development Services@gmail.com. Or you can come and visit me at 41 Perry Street. So that's the Wairarapa Community Centre. And I do have a little flyer here that Bev's given me, who's the manager of the Wairarapa Community Centre, just letting you know what's going on there at the moment. So firstly, they are always looking for volunteer cooks to cook the meals for the community kitchen, where they freeze lovely meals for people that are having some challenge in their life to be able to give away to them. So the Why Waste provides leftover food. They have community cooks that go in, people that volunteer to go in and cook meals and freeze them all up, and then they are given by agencies to people in need. So if you feel that that's something you would love to give some time and energy to, you are more than welcome. Just pop into 41 Perry Street and talk to Bev. Ask for Bev. They also have the community cooking classes starting, a free community cooking class, free morning workshop. Now, this is coming up very soon. I think it's this Friday, and forgive me because I cannot read this flyer that Bev has given me. But they have a Facebook page and a website that you're able to go to, or you can give Bev a phone call at the Wairarapa Community Centre, or pop in and see Bev. So there's two awesome things that they do there. Our family do, once a term, we do cooking for the community thing. We get together as a family in the evening, all of the kids and all of our family together, and we get the kids peeling the spuds and the dads, you know, stirring the great big pots, and the mums, you know, we all, and putting everything into containers and freezing it. It's such a rewarding and enriching thing to do for your family or your workplace or your sports team, or just as an individual. So yeah, something that just is a really great thing to do, and it is really good for the soul. So there we go. There's my show. I better just check the time. So I'll end it now. So this has been Donna on Motuoru Development's show. Next show that we have will be our youth in a fortnight on Wednesday afternoon, 3 to 5, or 3:30 to 5, I think. My apologies for not knowing the show, but this is what you get with me. This is who I am, and this is one of the things I've accepted. I'm a global person. I'm not a detail person, and I learn to live with that. I hope you've enjoyed this. Thank you, Arrow FM, for providing this platform for us to be able to do that. And they are amazing, and they have a fantastic website, so you can go and visit them on Arrow FM. Their website is very easy to use, and you can follow the links to listen to all of the shows. You can also watch it on the Wairarapa TV. And again, I've forgotten that one as well, but that will be on the website. Again, global thinker, not detail. Have a great day, and I look forward to talking to you again. And I'm going to get my music, sus, next time, so you can have some breaks from my voice. Enjoy the rest of your day, guys. Bye.